course, on this day, what we commemorate is our Lord's going to the cross at midday. The transference of the Blessed Sacrament from the chapel where it's reposed since last night, we will come out the side wall and come down the center aisle. What you'll notice that's significant about this ceremony is that, calling the sign of the chalice, we have on the preparatory altar, you notice on the side, just the chalice, in which there is water and wine, as usually prepared, but with just the small pall on top of it. It will be brought over after a long acclamation, diaconal acclamation, be brought over to the altar. Then when we wind up bringing the Blessed Sacrament in, the signing of the chalice is the uniting of our Lord's consecrated body from last night, the Last Supper, with the blood which is shed on Calvary, represented by simply the wine. But you'll notice that in the prayers indicate through the epiclesis and through this conjoining, even though there are no words of institution as we're used to at a Mass, that there is a transformation that takes place of this wine into our Lord's precious blood, the signing, the commingling. Mingling is precisely in the Syriac tradition the idea of how we are transformed by grace. Last night we spoke about our Lord being the medicine of God, the tree of life. And that reality of our Lord is present in the Holy Eucharist. That reality is because of the mingling, which is why we chose the anaphora of St. John Chrysostom last night. Because on a couple of occasions we have the prayers that the mingling of your body with our bodies and your blood with our souls, that we be transformed. In the Greek tradition, they use the term theosis, literally divinization. There is, to some extent, also in the Latin tradition, that idea. But the East is especially strong on the idea of the medicinal transformation of us in healing. And so when we bring this sacred body of the medicine of God, which is our divine Lord, body, blood, soul, and divinity, really, truly, and substantially present, under the appearances, and only the appearances of bread, that transformation in presence is that mingling that we receive in Holy Communion, that we ourselves be medicinally healed. So this evening, when we talk about the death of our Lord on Calvary, we'll talk about a different aspect of the living veil. But it's an important thing when we think about St. Paul, when he writes to the Romans in chapter 5, and it's a reading that we use for the morning office on Good Friday. St. Paul, when he writes to the Romans, he says, it would be difficult for us to find someone who would die for another person who was good. We have examples of it. We have an example recently in southern France of the policeman who exchanged himself for the hostage and wound up being put to death. He wound up being killed because of this. But he knew that he was sacrificing his life for this other person that he didn't know. And so St. Paul uses something along these same examples. It's rare, we celebrate it, it's so rare, that someone would give their life for another person, but a person who's good. And he says, so how much more is the death of our Lord when he died for us when we were his enemies? We were not his friends when he died on Calvary. It is precisely this reconciliation of the human race with God that our Lord's charity, this divine love, desires to bring about. So St. Paul says that the sense that we are to appreciate the fact is that the human race, we were not friends of this man who died for us. And so if we are redeemed, if we are purchased, and the notion of redeeming in the Syriac tradition, or in the Semitic tradition, is Gaol. And Gaol was a person within the family. So this notion of family, and usually it's the patriarch, Jiddu, who has the responsibility to protect everyone in his extended family. And if you have a younger brother or a cousin who's an idiot and winds up kind of all of his money disappears and his children are now going to be hungry, you have to get him back from that bad situation. I mean, you might beat him up later on. But Gaol, the Redeemer, you have that responsibility to protect if they were taken away, well, especially in the old days, carried off as slaves during some military campaign. You bought them back. You've got the money together to buy your stupid younger brother back. So the notion of redemption is that there is a protection and a family aspect that everyone is meant to be kept within the family and kept healthy. The redemption is not our Lord paid some kind of a fine. And that gives us, as we mentioned last night, tickets to go somewhere. It's a family which he constitutes around him, which was constituted in paradise, which we decided we didn't want, and like the prodigal son, we went stomping off, making up our own decisions as to how we thought things should be. And that clash throughout the generations and the centuries is what caused that enmity. That is not the family that God created. So in this, when our Lord says that the Son of Man has come not to serve, to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many, he's saying, I have come to purchase you back from your stupid gambling habits. I've come to purchase you back from your sensuality which plunges you in the gutter. I have come to redeem you from those things which have oppressed and enslaved you, which is why he says in the gospel, that by which we sin, we are servants to. That is the notion of redemption. To buy us back because we've wandered off and brought ourselves into hostages and as slaves of ultimately stupidity, our sins, our selfishness, our sensuality, our avarice, our anger. These things are what our Lord came to bring us back from. So when St. Paul writes in the letter to the Romans in chapter 5, and he says, you know, think about this. The day that he died on Calvary, no one was his friend, except the Mother of God. So we mentioned the other night, she's the only one for whom the faith remained burning. The lamp remained lit. Mary Magdalene is there, it is true. John is there, true. And there are a few others that are also there. They are there for the affection, which is good, but it's not supernatural. They do not believe in the resurrection. They do not expect to see him rise in glory, which is why they all show up at the tomb 3 days later. They do not expect it. They're only there from sentiment and affection, which is good, but not enough. And so even there, they have tripped up. The only one who stands at this cross, who loves supernaturally, who has retained her loyalty, her fidelity, her belief in this victorious ransom being given here, is one person, the Mother of God, Mary of Nazareth. That's it. One person of the entire human race. Which is why the Blessed Virgin Mary is referred to as the daughter of Zion. These prophecies in the Old Testament about Jerusalem, Zion, to rise up and to receive its Messiah, to rejoice. We heard it on Shanim. To rejoice from the prophet Zechariah, that your Savior comes to you seated upon a donkey. She is the one who embodies the reality of the fidelity of the city of God, Jerusalem. She is the one who stands at the foot of the cross, always believing, but also because of the sensitivity of her mind, her soul, her heart, the anguish that she suffered was all the more profound. It is sad enough if you were to consider any mother losing her child to an injustice and being publicly humiliated in this way. But it is the sensitivity and the sinlessness of her soul which makes this pain all the more profound. You think about when our children are little and they're talking to us, when we're busy making dinner. We hear them, we're not ignoring them, but we're distracted. So we hear, it doesn't matter, she's only four, right? So we're distracted with other things. So we're not really listening fully attentively. And we rarely ever listen fully attentively to anyone in any case, because we're distracted. But if you have the soul of perfect and sheer lucidity and sinlessness, in which the mind in its clarity focused upon God and was transformed by grace, everything that is heard, sensed, experienced, thought on, meditated on, prayed on, has all the more profound reality of having that receptivity. That is what happens with our Lord and our Lady during these 3 days. While all of us can be sympathetic to a level of being betrayed by your most intimate friends, and may have even had the experience of having that done to us, none of us can really understand the degree of how profound the essentially loving heart of God incarnate, of what that betrayal meant to him. All the more profound in this reality taking place, and therefore in the sinlessness of the Mother of God as she stood there, she is the great consolation to our Lord, if there is any on Calvary. But when St. Paul says that if this has been the ransom given to us and we are reconciled through his death, and how much more by his life? That resurrection and that triumph also is what brings the light and the glory into our lives. So what we contemplate this morning, this early afternoon, is the beginning of the whole route of Calvary. The weights placed upon our Lord, the humiliation, the jeering, the mockery, and also the fact that he suffers by the fact of what his mother has to undergo. Oh, you know that in the Talmud, the Blessed Virgin Mary is obviously not referred to as the Blessed Virgin Mary in the Talmud. She's portrayed as being some bimbo hairdresser who happened to shack up at one point with some Roman soldier. That's where Jesus came from. That's the portrayal by the Pharisees to this day of who this woman was. And I only bring it out today because that's one statement written that's been there for centuries. But to think on that day, especially for those who know the intimacy in a Middle Eastern culture between mothers and their sons and sons and their mothers, of how much pain he had by hearing the jeers in the crowd, not just mocking him as being a false Messiah, but what he hears, the blasphemies against his mother in this crowd. Because she's there the whole time. These are the things that we contemplate in this early afternoon leading up to our Lord's death. And tonight, we'll come back to that moment of death as we do the death and burial of our Lord. May that Mother of God, in her purity of soul and of that heart that was pierced by a sword, and as Simeon said decades before when our Lord was a baby, your soul, your heart shall be pierced so that many thoughts may be revealed. Kind of mysterious. But our reaction to this moment of our Lord's passion and death reveals who we truly are as individuals. Your soul shall be pierced so that the thoughts of many will be revealed. You're here today. You're not at the mall. You're not out doing whatever, planning for just some frivolous weekend. That is a gift that our Lord has touched our hearts, given us the ability to see, however much we think we live, see this mystery. And for that, as St. Paul says, when we've appreciated what it meant that our Lord ransomed me, I am the stupid little brother. I'm the idiot who's gambled away my children's goods. When I realize that, my heart has nothing to do but then to swell with gratitude and thanksgiving for this great sacrifice. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.